Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is Pastor Raziel McFall, citizen of the Kingdom of God and ambassador of Christ. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God said, "Let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion." My fellow believer, this was God's primary motivation and purpose for creating man. In the beginning, our God gave mankind a kingdom and not a religion. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, Jesus outlines what should be the priorities of man. Every man should busy himself seeking God's kingdom and his righteousness. If the church is to be delivered from the limitations of this world and begin to experience the victory and abundant life that Jesus came to make available to us, we must become more knowledgeable about the kingdom of God and commit ourselves to walking in his righteousness. As you listen to the following message, it is our prayer that you receive insight into God's kingdom and be delivered from the spirit of religion that has held God's people captive for generations. God bless and strengthen you as you listen to the word of God.
Let the kings worship him today. Let the kings worship him.
As you can see, our overall topic continues to be the kingdom of God. Our subtopic tonight is divine healing, citizens' right, and manifestation of kingdom culture. Divine healing, citizens' right, and manifestation of kingdom culture. Well, we want to begin with a word from the prophet Isaiah as he began to paint a picture of the ministry of the Messiah that was to come. Here's what Isaiah said about this Messiah, this Christ Jesus, who was supposed to come as he prophesied. This is Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1. Isaiah says here, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound." Now, Christ Jesus declared fulfillment of this prophecy by Isaiah as he returned from being tempted by the enemy. Now, as Christ read this Old Testament scripture and confirmed its fulfillment, he effectively outlined the key features, characteristics, nature, and philosophy of his ministry. Here's how Jesus read this scripture and outlined the key features of his own public ministry. The Bible says here in Luke chapter 4, verse 18, Jesus said, as he read this scripture, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised." Now, if you look closely at Jesus' declaration here, the Spirit of the Lord was placed upon him to anoint and empower him to do three primary things. Firstly, the Spirit of the Lord was upon him to preach the gospel to the poor. Then, the Spirit of the Lord was upon him to heal, and the Spirit of the Lord was upon him to set people free. And so these were the three primary components of Jesus' public ministry. Now, with regard to this primary function of preaching the gospel, what is this gospel that Jesus was anointed to preach? Remember that Jesus said that he was anointed to preach the gospel to the poor. Well, the first words of the Sermon on the Mount, as recorded by Luke, give us an indication of what this gospel was that Jesus preached to the poor. Here it is. This is Luke chapter 6, verse 20. Jesus said here as he began the Sermon on the Mount, according to Luke, "Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." And so Jesus declared that he was anointed to preach the gospel to the poor, and the very first words of his most popular sermon was, "Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." Jesus declared that the accessibility and availability of the kingdom of God to the poor, or to the poor in spirit as Matthew records it, is the gospel that he was anointed to preach. Now, Jesus also confirmed what he considered to be the gospel in the very first words of his public ministry. Again, Jesus also confirmed what he considered to be the gospel in the very first words of his public ministry, as recorded by St. Mark. Here it is. This is Mark chapter 1, verses 14 to 15. The Bible says, "Now, after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God." And what was this gospel that Jesus came preaching? Well, here it is in the very next verse, Mark chapter 1, verse 15. "He came preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel.'" Notice, Jesus called the declaration that the kingdom of God was at hand or had arrived the gospel. This was the gospel that he was anointed to preach to the poor. Jesus again confirmed the gospel that he was anointed to preach when he outlined why he was sent. Here it is in Luke chapter 4, verse 43. Jesus says a word here to us. He said, "I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also, for therefore am I sent." Christ Jesus advised that he was sent to preach the kingdom of God, but he said that the Spirit of the Lord was upon him because he was anointed to preach the gospel to the poor. And so, my fellow believer, the gospel of the kingdom was this gospel that Jesus Christ was anointed to preach to the poor, or to the poor in spirit. This was the good news, my fellow believer, and the only recorded message that Jesus preached. I know that might cause some concern for some of my fellow believers, but if you take a look in your Bible, you will see that the gospel of the kingdom was the only message preached by Christ Jesus, and we will see that it was the only specific message that he instructed his disciples to preach. This was the good news, my fellow believer. And so what is this gospel that Jesus was anointed to preach? Well, here it is. The fact that the kingdom, rule, government, influence, power, and authority of the King of Heaven has arrived and is now operational on the earth. And mankind has access to this kingdom and are now able to benefit from life under God's government through Christ Jesus is the gospel. Again, the fact that the kingdom, rule, government, influence, power, and authority of the King of Heaven has arrived and is now operational on the earth. And mankind has access to this kingdom and are now able to benefit from life under God's government through Christ Jesus is the gospel. Jesus came preaching the gospel and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand." This is the gospel that Jesus preached, my fellow believer. This was the gospel that Christ Jesus preached. And again, we say it was the only specific gospel that he instructed his disciples to preach. And so, as we said, Jesus' ministry was comprised of three primary components. He preached the gospel, he healed, and he set people free. Now, numbers 2 and 3 were intended to provide support for number 1. But as we just learned, this gospel that Jesus preached was the gospel of the kingdom. As Jesus declared that the kingdom of God had arrived on the earth, he healed and set people free and performed extraordinary works to prove, confirm, and verify his message of the kingdom's arrival. And so again, we say numbers 2 and 3 were meant to provide support for number 1. Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom. Then he healed all the sick people and he set people free, cast out demons to confirm that the kingdom of God had arrived on the earth. Here's a record of Jesus' public ministry to confirm this operation. This is Matthew chapter 4, verse 23. The Bible says, "And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues." What was he doing? He was preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. The Bible teaches that as Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom of God, or let people know that the government or rule of God had arrived and was operational on the earth, he confirmed this message by healing every manner of sickness and every manner of disease among the people. It made no difference whether the person had a headache, cancer, or leprosy. The Bible says that he healed all manner of sickness and all manner of diseases to confirm and verify his message that the kingdom of God had arrived on the earth. Here's another record of Jesus' public ministry. Here it is in Matthew chapter 9, verse 35. The Bible says, "And Jesus went about all the cities and the villages, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people." I continue to challenge the people of God to take another look in your Bible. You will see that practically every time Christ Jesus opened his mouth, he was speaking about one thing. He was speaking about the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven. Christ Jesus was strictly kingdom focused. But the Bible teaches that he went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. We just saw that Jesus healed all types of sickness and disease as he sought to verify his message of the kingdom's arrival, presence, and operation on the earth. Now Matthew lets us know that he not only healed all types of sicknesses and diseases, but he also healed all sick people that he encountered. Again, Matthew lets us know that Christ Jesus not only healed all types of sickness and disease, but he also healed all sick people that he encountered. He healed all types of diseases and sicknesses, and he also healed all sick people. So you don't have to worry, my fellow believer, if it is God's will for you to be healed. Christ Jesus healed all manner of sickness, all manner of disease, and Christ Jesus healed every single sick person that he came in contact with. Here's what the Bible says happened after Jesus sent out his 12 disciples to minister, and he took them aside to discuss their ministry. This is Luke chapter 9, verse 11. The Bible says, "And the people, when they knew it, followed him, and he received them, and what did he do? And spake unto them of the kingdom of God, and healed them that had need of healing." Notice, after Jesus spoke to these people about the kingdom of God, he healed every person that needed healing. If you look in your Bible, Jesus Christ never turned down an invitation to go and minister to somebody. Whether it was the centurion, whether it was Jairus, every single person that came and invited Jesus to come and minister to them, Jesus Christ responded positively to that invitation, and he moved quickly and he said, "I will come and heal him." And Jesus always ministered to these people, and we will see why Jesus Christ was so actively seeking to heal practically every single person that he came in contact with. And so again, my fellow believer, Jesus wants to heal you today, because even here the Bible says that he healed all those that had need of healing. Now, not only did Christ Jesus preached the gospel, healed the sick, and demonstrated kingdom power and authority over devils through deliverance, he also empowered and instructed his disciples to do the same things. Here it is. This is Luke chapter 9, verses 1 to 2. Again, I continue to challenge the people of God. Take another look in your Bible. The Bible says here in Luke chapter 9, verses 1 to 2, in verse 1 it says, "Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases." And so his disciples were given the same power and authority that he had. Then look at what he did consistent with his own ministry. This is Luke chapter 9, verse 2. "And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick." And so Jesus instructed and empowered his disciples to do the same things that he was doing. Now, here's how Matthew describes Jesus' commissioning of his 12 disciples. Firstly, this is Matthew chapter 10, verse 1. "We bless the Lord because we believe that he's still in the healing business. He's still in the deliverance business. But we believe that he wants to heal and deliver and perform extraordinary works to confirm and verify the message and the gospel of the kingdom." But here it is. This is Matthew chapter 10, verse 1. The Bible says, "And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease." And so Jesus Christ was not intimidated by any type of disease. he and his disciples were able to heal stage 4 cancer just as easily as they could heal a headache. And so the Bible teaches that he sent them out. He gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. My fellow believer, it makes no difference what type of disease you have today, what type of sickness you have today. There is power available in this balm of Gilead. And we thank God that even as he has given his disciples power and authority to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of diseases, he has done the same thing to us. Because the Bible teaches in St. John chapter 14, verse 12, he said, "Verily, verily, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do." We dare to take him at his word, and we bless the Lord that there shall be a manifestation and confirmation that the kingdom of God is here and is operational and is present and active on the earth. Now, because the same spirit that Jesus declared was upon him was being placed upon his disciples, they were empowered to execute the very same functions that Jesus did. Then Jesus gave them specific instructions. Take a look at this, my fellow believer. We continue to challenge the people of God to take another look in their Bibles. Look at what Jesus told his 12 disciples. This is Matthew chapter 10, verse 7. He told them, "As ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Again, Jesus gave his disciples a specific message to preach. As you go, I want you to let people know that the kingdom of heaven is at hand, or the kingdom of heaven had come near, or the kingdom of heaven had arrived. Now, because these were Jesus' disciples, he instructed them to preach the same message that he preached. He told them to go and let people know that the kingdom or government, influence, power, and authority of the King of Heaven had arrived on the earth, and that they had access to this kingdom and can now come under God's government and experience the culture, benefits, and the privileges of life in this kingdom. This is what Jesus told his disciples to do. Go and let people know that the kingdom or government, influence, power, and authority of the King of Heaven had arrived on the earth, and that they now had access to this kingdom, and that they could now come under God's government. Remember now, Isaiah said that Jesus came with government upon his shoulder. And so his disciples were sent out to let people know that they can now come under God's government. They can now enter his kingdom. They now have access to his kingdom, and they could thereby experience the culture, benefits, and privileges of life in God's kingdom. Remember, Jesus said that he came that we might have life and life more abundantly. This is the message that the people of God need to hear, my fellow believer. We need to hear that there is life in this kingdom, that there are benefits to serving the Lord, and the benefits are available to us as Christ Jesus manifests the culture, power, and authority of his kingdom. Then Jesus told them to perform extraordinary works to confirm, verify, and authenticate their message of the kingdom's arrival, presence, and operation. Here it is in verse 8. He told them, "As ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Then he told them to heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely ye have received, freely give. And so Jesus told them to go and let people know that the kingdom of heaven has arrived or is at hand. Then he told them to confirm and validate and authenticate and verify their message of the kingdom's presence and arrival and operation on the earth by manifesting the culture, power, and authority of the kingdom through healing and deliverance. This is what Jesus instructed his disciples to do, and this is what he expects his church to do today, my fellow believer. I still believe that this gospel of the kingdom is the missing link in the church. You will see a little later a word that the Lord spoke to my spirit as I was in prayer today. And so after the 12, Christ Jesus also sent out another 70 disciples. Here's what he said to them. This is Luke chapter 10, verses 8 to 9. If you notice, we love to put the word of God before the eyes of the people of God. We want you to hear the word of God, and we want you to see the word of God, because we know that this gospel of the kingdom is new to many of us. So we need to keep this word before your face so that you can see the things that we're saying. But as Jesus sent out these 70 apostles after he sent out the 12, the Bible says here in Luke chapter 10, verses 8 to 9, he told them, "And into whatsoever city ye enter, and they receive you, eat such things as are set before you. Then look at verse 9 of Luke 10. Then he told the 70 apostles, and heal the sick that are therein, and say unto them, the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you. And so Jesus instructed the 70 apostles to heal all the sick people, then let them know that their healing was as a result of the presence and operation of the kingdom of God. He told them to heal the sick and let the people know that they were healed because the kingdom of God had come nigh unto them. This was exactly what Jesus and his 12 disciples did and what he expects the church to do today. Again, I say, I believe that this is the missing link in the body of Christ. The body of Christ needs to preach the gospel of the kingdom, which is the only message preached by Christ Jesus and the only specific message that he instructed his disciples to preach, my fellow believer. I know that that might cause some problems for somebody, but I want you to take another look in the Word of God. Now, the question is, why was healing used as a tangible confirmation that the kingdom of God had arrived on the earth? Why was healing used as a tangible confirmation that the kingdom of God had arrived on the earth? Well, remember what Christ Jesus said about his mission and that of the prince of darkness or the enemy or the devil. This is St. John chapter 10, verse 10. The Bible says here, the thief cometh not, but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. This was the devil's mission statement. But Jesus Christ went on to say what he came to do. This is the second part of St. John chapter 10, verse 10. Jesus said, I am come that they might have life. That is the God kind of life, and that they might have it more abundantly. This life that Jesus referred to here when he said he came that we might have life is the Zoe, or the God kind of life. But then Jesus said that he came that we might have this God kind of life more abundantly. The thief wants us to be exposed to a culture of sin and hatred, death, defeat, depression, lack, sickness, bondage, and limitation. God and Christ want us to be introduced to a new normal. The world is speaking about a new normal, but I believe that the body of Christ needs to be introduced to a new normal of life in God's kingdom and under God's government. God and Christ want us to be introduced to a new normal of the culture of the kingdom of heaven, which includes righteousness, forgiveness, love, peace, joy, strength for our trials, possibilities, healing, deliverance, authority, power, and abundant provision of our needs. He wants us to be exposed to and to experience the quality of life under God's government and in God's kingdom. My fellow believer, sickness and disease are some of the major tools used by the enemy in execution of his mission to steal, kill, and destroy. Again, sickness and disease are some of the major tools used by the enemy in execution of his mission to steal, kill, and destroy. But here's what the Bible says about why Christ Jesus was manifested. This is 1 John chapter 3, verse 8. The Bible says here in John's first epistle, for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. And so even as the devil came to steal and to kill and to destroy, and he's using sickness and disease as some of the major tools in execution of his mission, the Bible says that for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested. Why? That he might destroy the works of the devil. Let's take a closer look at this word destroy here. The word destroy is the Greek word luo. That's L-U-O. It means to break up. It means to loosen, dissolve, melt, and put off. My fellow believer, don't you ever let anyone convince you that God puts sickness on believers to make them humble or for any other reason. Sickness and disease are tools of the devil used to steal, kill, and to destroy. And Jesus came to destroy, break up, and put off all the works of the devil, including sickness and disease. Again, we reiterate that sickness and disease are tools of the devil used to steal and to kill and to destroy. But we praise God that the Son of God was manifested to break up, to loosen, to dissolve, and to melt off every work of the kingdom of darkness. Jesus confirmed that sickness is from the devil as he encountered a woman who was sick for 18 years. Here's what Jesus said about her in Luke chapter 13, verse 16. The Bible says here in Luke 13 and 16, Jesus said, "And ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan had bound, lo, these 18 years, be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath day?" Jesus highlighted the fact that this woman was a daughter of Abraham. She therefore had legal rights and was entitled to benefits and privileges from the kingdom of heaven based on the covenant that God made with Father Abraham. We'll discuss rights a little later in this message, but it is no accident that Jesus said that this woman was a daughter of Abraham. She had a legal right to this healing, as we will see a little later in this message. But Jesus clearly defined the source of this woman's infirmity as Satan, the devil. Jesus said, "This woman whom Satan had bound, lo, these 18 years, he said that she should be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath day." You see the word loosed here. Let's take a closer look at this word loosed. You will not believe what this word loosed is. This word loosed is the same Greek word luo. It means to break up, to destroy, to dissolve, to melt, and to put off. And so Jesus confirmed that sickness is oppression from the devil, and this woman needed to be loosed, or this sickness and disease needed to be broken or destroyed or dissolved or melted or put off her. This is what Jesus was saying. Jesus' mission was obviously to undo and destroy the works of the devil, of which sickness was a major part and continues to be a major part. Here's Peter's description of Jesus' work as he addressed the people gathered at Cornelius' house. Peter again confirmed that sickness and disease is from the devil and from the kingdom of darkness. This is Acts chapter 10, verse 38. Peter said here how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Who did Jesus heal? He healed all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. We praise God that even as God was with Christ Jesus, he is with us today. And Jesus told us that as the Father had sent him out, he has sent us out with the same power and authority. And so even as the Father was with Christ Jesus, and he was thereby anointed and empowered to heal everyone who were oppressed of the devil, we thank God that the same power and authority are available to the people of God today. But the Bible says that Jesus went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. This word oppressed means to exercise dominion against. And so the Bible teaches that Jesus Christ went about healing all that the enemy was exercising dominion against. According to Peter, whenever Jesus Christ encountered a sick person, he considered the enemy to be exercising dominion over them. And because Satan's reign on the earth is illegal, that is, God did not authorize it, Christ felt compelled to superimpose the culture and influence of the kingdom of heaven and perform healing. Every time Jesus came in contact with a sick person, he determined that they were being oppressed by the devil, or the devil was exercising dominion over them. And again, we say, because Satan's reign on the earth is illegal, remember Adam and Eve gave him his authority, but it did not come directly from the source, who was God. And so Christ Jesus felt compelled to superimpose the culture of healing, the culture of deliverance, the culture of the kingdom of God, and to bring forth healing to these people. My brother and my sister, the enemy is no longer authorized to exercise dominion against you because you are no longer a citizen of his kingdom. Again, my brother and my sister, the people of God will be set free tonight by this word. The Bible teaches that through knowledge the just shall be delivered. And so we thank God that knowledge is power, but the enemy is no longer authorized to exercise dominion against you because you are no longer a citizen of his kingdom. As a result of your salvation, you are now a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. I bless the Lord because I was in church for a very long time and nobody told me that I was a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. I was told that I was prepared to go to heaven when I die, but nobody told me that right here and right now, I am a citizen of God's heavenly kingdom with all the rights, privileges, and benefits that relate thereto. And so now I have access to the resources of God's heavenly kingdom. This is why Jesus said that he gave unto us the keys of the kingdom. Why? Because we are now citizens of another kingdom. And so, my fellow believer, because you are no longer a citizen of the kingdom of darkness, the enemy no longer has any right or jurisdiction over you. Remember that we were all born in the kingdom of darkness by virtue of Adam and Eve's rebellion. But, my fellow believer, you entered another kingdom when you were born again. This is why the people of God need to hear this gospel of the kingdom. We need to understand all that Jesus Christ made available to us and what we have access to by virtue of our salvation. As a result of your salvation, again, we say, you are now a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. Remember what Christ Jesus said to Nicodemus here in St. John chapter 3, verse 5. Jesus told Nicodemus, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." I am sure many of us grew up in church, and many of us still believe that Jesus Christ was speaking here about the heaven that we hope to go to in the sweet by and by when we die. But Christ Jesus was speaking about immediate entry into God's kingdom. Christ Jesus came with government upon his shoulder, and he was telling Nicodemus that if he expected to enter or to gain access to God's kingdom right here and right now, he had to be born of the water and of the Spirit. And so Jesus told Nicodemus that except he was born again, he could not come into the kingdom of God. My fellow believer, again we say, when you were born again, you entered or you came into God's kingdom. The government of the kingdom of heaven is now responsible for you, my fellow believer. You are no longer bound by this world's five loaves and two fish. You are no longer bound by the limitations of your doctor. You need to know that you are now connected to another kingdom whose king is able to do everything and anything, and with him there are no impossibilities. You now have access to resources from another kingdom. And so this is why the people of God need to hear this gospel of the kingdom. The people of God need to know that the government of the kingdom of heaven is now responsible for you. Remember again, the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, "Unto us a child is born, a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder." Christ Jesus did not come to establish a religion. He came to reestablish God's kingdom government on the earth. He came to wash you in his blood so that you can now have access to God's kingdom. And this is not in the sweet by and by. This is right here and right now, my fellow believer. You have access to benefits and privileges and rights in God's kingdom because of your citizenship and your sonship, my fellow believer. Paul the Apostle lets us know what happened to us when we were born again. Here it is in Colossians chapter 1, verses 12 to 13. Paul said a word here, "giving thanks unto the Father, which had made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light." Then look at what Paul says to you, my fellow believer. This is Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. "Who hath delivered us from the power or the kingdom of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son." Remember that as a result of Adam and Eve's rebellion, we were all born in the kingdom of darkness under the control and jurisdiction of that devil. But when we were born again, we were transferred from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light or the kingdom of God. And so the enemy no longer has dominion over you. You are no longer a citizen of his kingdom. He no longer has jurisdiction over you, my fellow believer. And you are now a citizen of another kingdom. And you are now a child of God. And so the people of God need to understand this. Again, I say this is why we in the church need to hear this gospel of the kingdom. Here's what Paul says to us again through his letter to the Ephesians. This is Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. The people of God need to be made aware of their citizenship. I'm sure you know that citizenship implies a legal contract with the government. The government of that home country, the country where you are a citizen, is personally responsible for you. And again, I let the people of God know, you do not have to be in the home country in order to receive benefits from your government. For example, if you're overseas and you run into problems and you lose your passport or something, all you have to do is to find an embassy or a consulate of your home country, and you will get help, my fellow believer. And so if worldly governments have put systems in place to take care of their citizens whilst they are outside of the home country, what do you think about the kingdom of heaven, my fellow believer? You do not have to be in heaven, which is the home country, in order to experience the benefits from this kingdom. Just as worldly governments have put systems in place to take care of their citizens, the government of the kingdom of heaven has put systems in place to take care of their citizens, even though we are not yet in the home country. And so the people of God need to understand all that Christ Jesus has made available to them. But here's what Paul the Apostle says to you through his letter to the Ephesians. This is Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. Paul says, now, look at the first word in this verse. Now, therefore, ye are. We're not talking about the sweet by and by, my fellow believer. Paul says, now, therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. And so, my fellow believer, if you are no longer a stranger and a foreigner, you must be a citizen. But again, notice the first few words of this verse. Now you are. Now ye are. You are a fellow citizen with the saints, and you are of God's household. You are part of God's family, my fellow believer, and you are a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. And by virtue of your citizenship, you have access to certain rights and privileges and benefits. And we will soon see some of these rights, privileges, and benefits which are outlined in the constitution of the kingdom, which is the Bible. Here's Paul again to the Philippians. This is Philippians chapter 3, verse 20. We went to the New King James Version for this one. If you are looking in the King James Version, you will see that the Bible says, for our conversation is in heaven. The word conversation is the Greek word polituma. That's P-O-L-I-T-E-U-M-A. That word means community, and it also means citizenship. And so for this reason, we went directly to the New King James Version of this scripture, Philippians chapter 3, verse 20. This scripture says, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, my brother and my sister, your citizenship is now in heaven. You are still in this world, but you are no longer of this world. Again, the King, government, and kingdom of heaven are now personally responsible for your well-being. The enemy no longer has jurisdiction or authority over you. Not only so, but you are now an ambassador for Christ. And by virtue of your ambassadorship, you have received diplomatic immunity. And so the people of God need to understand all that Christ Jesus has made available to us. The Bible says that through knowledge shall the just be delivered. And so as we begin to preach this gospel of the kingdom, as we begin to hear this gospel of the kingdom, we begin to understand and receive a revelation of all the things that Christ Jesus has made available to us. The saints of God need to know that our citizenship is now in heaven. This is about citizenship right here and right now. He's not talking about in the sweet by and by when you die. This is the gospel, or the good news that Jesus preached, my fellow believer. Jesus came letting people know that the kingdom of God had arrived on the earth, and that mankind now have access to this kingdom. Mankind can now come under God's government. Mankind can experience the benefits from life under God's government and in this kingdom. This was the gospel that Jesus Christ preached. This was the gospel that he instructed his disciples to preach, and this is the gospel that he expects the church to preach today. I continue to tell you, my fellow believer, this is the missing link in the body of Christ. This is why the governments of the world can call us non-essential, unimportant, unnecessary, disposable. This is how they see us. Why? Because we are operating just like every other religion, with a focus on going to heaven when we die. But Christ Jesus has empowered us, and he's given us access to the resources of his Father's heavenly kingdom, so that we can be the light of the world, so that we can be the salt of the earth, so that we can impact this earth and influence this earth and help to bring it under God's kingdom government, so that we can show the world what God is like, so that we can manifest the culture, power, and authority of his kingdom, so that we can demonstrate to people the quality of life under God's government and in God's kingdom. Jesus came that we might have life, and that we might have it more abundantly. This is not just about you packing up and going to heaven when you die, my fellow believer. Jesus made some things available to you right here and right now, my fellow believer. This was the gospel that Jesus preached. Jesus came letting somebody know that the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God has arrived. And this is the message that we come declaring tonight. And because we are preaching this gospel of the kingdom, our expectation is that Christ Jesus will manifest. He will prove and authenticate and confirm, verify and validate this message. I believe even as we share this word tonight, somebody's being healed right now. Why? Because he is confirming that the kingdom of God is here. This is what Jesus Christ was doing. He was declaring that the kingdom is here. Then he was proving that the kingdom was here by healing all manner of sickness, casting out devils, performing extraordinary works. I declare by the power vested in me as an envoy, as an ambassador of God's kingdom, as we share this word tonight, somebody's being healed right now because Jesus Christ is confirming to you that his kingdom is here. Jesus wants to let us know that citizenship in his Father's kingdom is now available to all mankind. This is the gospel of the kingdom. Let me reiterate to you, my fellow believer, when you were born again, you immediately became a fully naturalized citizen of God's heavenly kingdom with all the rights, privileges, benefits, power, and authority that relate to this prestigious position. Again, when you were born again, you immediately became a fully naturalized citizen of God's heavenly kingdom with all the rights, privileges, benefits, power, and authority that relate to this prestigious position. Immediately, my fellow believer, this is where the rights that you have came from. Citizens of any country or kingdom have certain rights, privileges, and benefits that they are entitled to. You are now a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus encouraged us to seek this kingdom as a priority as he outlined the major benefit of this action. Here it is. This is Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. Because you enter this kingdom, he told us to make the kingdom of God and the righteousness of God the priorities in our lives. This is Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. Jesus said, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." You know, it just blows me away that Jesus gives us these simple instructions, but we in the church, we just decide not to do it, and we're still wondering why our needs are not being met. Jesus said, "Listen to me, man. Make the kingdom of God and the righteousness of God the priorities in your life, and everything that you need would be added unto you." I don't know what could be so difficult about that, my fellow believer, but what is Jesus saying to us here? This means that because we have now entered or become citizens of a new kingdom, if we are to partake of the rights, privileges, and benefits of our citizenship, we must, as a priority, become familiar with what it means to live in this kingdom and also to align ourselves with the government and laws of this kingdom. That's all righteousness is, you know. Righteousness says, "Listen to me, I've become a citizen of this country, of this kingdom, and I am going to align myself with the laws and principles and protocols of this country." That's all righteousness is, nothing fancy. And so Jesus tells us, "Listen to me, man. Seek to understand this kingdom. Seek to understand how it operates. Seek to understand what are your obligations as a citizen of this kingdom. Seek to understand the rights and privileges and benefits that accrue to you by virtue of your citizenship, and stay in right alignment with the government of this kingdom, and everything that you need will be added unto you." I don't know what could be more simple than that. Now, if I am called upon to seek a country or a kingdom, I believe a close review of its constitution is a good place to start. If somebody tells you to seek a country or a kingdom, we need to grab hold of the constitution of that country or that kingdom. Well, my fellow believer, the Bible includes the constitution of the kingdom of heaven that you became a citizen of when you were born again. The Bible, as the constitution of the kingdom of heaven, outlines your obligations, rights, privileges, and benefits as a kingdom citizen. A major benefit of your kingdom citizenship is the right to divine health. Again, a major benefit of your kingdom citizenship is the right to divine health. And so what does the constitution of this kingdom that you are now a citizen of have to say about this particular benefit? What does the constitution of your kingdom, the kingdom that you are now a citizen of, have to say about your right to divine health? Well, shortly after the children of Israel left Egypt, God outlined certain benefits that came with serving and being obedient to him. He also defined himself to the children of Israel. Here's one such benefit. This is Exodus chapter 15, verse 26. God told them, "If thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and wilt do that which is right in his sight, and wilt give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, then God said, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee." Notice God didn't say he's the Lord that healed us or healed us. He said that he's the Lord that healeth us. This is present continuous tense. And so even as God was healer to the children of Israel, he's healer to us today. Here's another benefit included in your kingdom's constitution. I need somebody to take a look at this, and I need you to let this sink into your spirit. This is Exodus chapter 23, verse 25. Here's a promise from our God. This is included in your kingdom's constitution. God said, "And ye shall serve the Lord your God, and he shall bless thy bread and thy water." Then he said, "I will take sickness away from the midst of thee." I wonder if this is in your Bible. God said, if you serve him, he will bless your bread and your water. He will supply your needs. But he also said that he will take sickness away from the midst of us. This is included in your kingdom's constitution. This is a powerful promise from our God that we must embrace and seek to walk in, my fellow believer. This is what's been made available to the people of God by virtue of their sonship and their citizenship. Here's another constitutional benefit of the kingdom of heaven. This is Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 15. "And the Lord will take away from thee all sickness. And the Lord will take away from thee all sickness. And will put none of the evil diseases of Egypt, which thou knowest, upon thee, but will lay them upon all them that hate thee." Here's a prophetic word through King David, also included in your kingdom's constitution. This is Psalm 91, verses 9 to 10. David said, "Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation." Look at verse 10 of Psalm 91. "There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling." COVID-19 is a plague. Cancer is a plague. Sugar diabetes is a plague. Hypertension is a plague. And so the people of God need to understand who we are. And so we need to understand that that enemy has no right to put any sickness on you, because you are no longer a citizen of his heavenly kingdom. I believe that somebody is being healed right now. I say the kingdom of God has come to the people of God. And I thank you, Father, even now for manifesting the presence and operation of your kingdom, even as we're sharing this word tonight. Now, one might say that these constitutional benefits were only available to the children of Israel under the Old Testament. But here's what Paul the Apostle said about Jesus' role in establishing the New Testament that we are now part of. This is Hebrews chapter 8, verse 6. Somebody might say, those are Old Testament benefits. But here's what Paul says to you. "But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator." He is Christ Jesus now. Jesus is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. And so you might say that those are Old Testament benefits, but you are now part of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. We praise the Lord that we have access to better promises under this New Testament. The New Testament, or the New Covenant, was established by the shedding of Jesus' blood on the cross. In addition to our redemption and reconciliation to the Father, the prophet Isaiah let us know certain other benefits that became available to us under this New Testament. Yes, we were born again. Yes, we were redeemed. But here's what the prophet Isaiah said about the work that Christ Jesus did on the cross. This is Isaiah chapter 53, verses 4 to 5. Isaiah says, "Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted." The Bible teaches that this Lamb bore our griefs and carried our sorrows. Then it went on to let us know the benefits of Jesus bearing our griefs and carrying our sorrows. Here it is in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5. The Bible says, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities." It says, "The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed." And so even as Jesus Christ took stripes, my fellow believer, even as he died on the cross, even as he bled for you, he was not only concerned about your redemption, but he was also concerned about your well-being. He was concerned about your deliverance. He was concerned about your healing. And so he took stripes for your sickness and disease, my fellow believer. Not only did Jesus make provision for the cleansing of our sins and our iniquities, but the Bible also teaches that with his stripes we are healed. And so what's the connection between these griefs and these sorrows that the Bible said that Jesus carried and he bore here, and the fact that with his stripes we are healed that Isaiah speaks about here? What is the connection between these griefs and these sorrows that he bore and that he carried, and these stripes Isaiah said that we are healed by? Well, the answer is provided in the book of Matthew, my fellow believer. This is Matthew chapter 8, verses 16 to 17. The Bible says here in verse 16, when the even was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils, and he cast out the spirits with his word, and healed some that were sick. No, my fellow believer, the Bible says, and heal all that were sick. You do not have to worry and wonder if Jesus wants to heal you, if God wants to heal you. I tell you, my fellow believer, look into your Bible. Jesus Christ never turned down an invitation to go and heal or minister to anybody. The Bible says here that all of these people came to him. They were demon-possessed. They were sick. But the Bible says that he healed all that were sick. And then Matthew went on and he clarified with those griefs and those sorrows that the Bible teaches that Jesus bore and he carried. Here it is in Matthew chapter 8, verse 17. Why did Jesus heal all that were sick? That it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah, that's Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. And so the griefs and sorrows that Isaiah spoke about were our infirmities and our sicknesses. Isaiah said that Christ Jesus, the Lamb of God, bore them. And because he bore them, you do not have to bear them. Jesus Christ has already borne our sicknesses and our disease, my fellow believer, because he has already borne them, because he has already carried them. You do not have to carry them anymore. By his stripes, you are healed. Jesus Christ healed every sick person so that he could fulfill, which was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. Himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Many rights, privileges, and benefits became available to us as a result of our salvation, adoption into God's family, and naturalization into citizenship in God's kingdom. Unfortunately, in the church, we generally focus on redemption and forget about the other benefits. But King David encourages us to not forget all our benefits. This is Psalm 103, verses 1 to 3. David says to you tonight, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Here it is in verse 2 of Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. This is the word that the church needs. What we have done, we've gone to the cross, and we've taken our redemption, and we said that we are now ready to die. But unfortunately, many of God's people, they are not walking in all of the benefits that Christ Jesus has made available to us. He bore your sicknesses. He carried your diseases, my fellow believer. He took your infirmities. And here it is, David concludes here in Psalm 103, verse 3, who forgiveth all thine iniquities. And not only did he forgive our iniquities, but the Bible says, who healeth all thy diseases. And so we just saw that Jesus healed all sick people. Now David is letting us know that he heals all of our diseases. It makes no difference what type of disease we have. Christ Jesus has the power, and he's made this power available to us by virtue of our sonship and by virtue of our citizenship. Now, consistent with this benefit, the Bible teaches that Christ Jesus healed all sick people that came or were brought to him for healing. Here's what the Bible says in Matthew chapter 4, verse 24. We believe somebody's faith is being built up right now. We believe that somebody's being positioned to reach into the invisible kingdom and to receive their healing. We believe that somebody will be healed even as we share this word, because God will confirm that his kingdom is here. God will prove, authenticate, confirm, verify, and validate that the kingdom of God has arrived, that the kingdom of God is present, that the kingdom of God is operational on this earth by manifesting the culture, power, and authority of his kingdom, the culture of healing and deliverance. And so we thank God that even now, God is beginning to work in somebody's life to confirm that his kingdom is here. So the Bible teaches that we should not forget all his benefits and that he heals all of our diseases. And the Bible says that Christ Jesus healed all sick people. This is Matthew chapter 4, verse 24. The Bible says, and his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with divers diseases and torments, and those which were possessed with devils, and those which were lunatic, and those that had the palsy, and he healed them. Who did he heal? All sick people. Here's another record of Christ Jesus seeking to destroy the works of the devil and introduce the kingdom cultures of healing and deliverance. This is Luke chapter 6, verses 17 to 19. And he came down with them and stood in the plain and the company of his disciples and a great multitude of people out of all Judea and Jerusalem, and from the sea coast of Tyre and Sidon. The Bible says that these people came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. We believe that somebody came here tonight to hear this word and to be healed of their diseases. This is why people came to hear Christ Jesus, and this is why people should come to hear us in the church. They should not only come to hear us preach the word, but they should also come to be healed of their diseases. Notice, people not only came to hear him, but they also came with an expectation that they would be healed. But here it is in verse 18 of Luke 6, "And they that were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed." Look at verse 19. "And the whole multitude sought to touch him, for there went virtue out of him and healed them all." And so Christ Jesus healed all manner of sickness, all manner of disease, and he healed every sick person and every person who had a disease that were brought to him for ministry. Somebody needs to know that it's God's will for you to be healed, my fellow believer. Here's another report about Christ Jesus' ministry. This is Matthew chapter 12, verses 14 to 15. The Bible says, "Then the Pharisees went out and held a council against him, how they might destroy him." Here it is in verse 15. "But when Jesus knew it, he withdrew himself from thence, and great multitudes followed him, and he healed them all." Every single person was healed. Notice again, he healed every single sick person. Here's another occasion. This is Luke chapter 4, verse 40. "Now when the sun was setting, all they that had any sick with divers diseases brought them unto him, and he laid his hands on every one of them and healed them." Christ Jesus laid his hands on every one of them and healed them. He did not leave one person sick. Why? Because he was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. And the sickness and disease were part of the works of the devil. And so he was just fulfilling his mission to give us access to life and life more abundantly, and also to eradicate and to destroy the works of the devil. And so Jesus Christ sought to eliminate every indication of the devil's reign that was being manifested by this sickness and disease that were on these people's lives. Now, after his ascension, Christ Jesus' disciples were endued with the power of the Holy Ghost, and they too demonstrated the culture and the nature of the kingdom and ministered the right of divine health whenever and wherever possible. They too healed every sick person. Not only did Christ Jesus heal every sick person, but his apostles also healed every sick person. This is Acts chapter 5, verses 14 to 16. The Bible says, "And the believers were the more added to the Lord, multitudes, both of men and women." Here it is in verse 15 of Acts 5. "Insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at the least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them." Look at verse 16 of Acts 5. "There came also a multitude out of the cities round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folks and them which were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed every one." Every single sick person was healed. And so we thank God that the same power and authority rests upon us today. We bless the name of Jesus as we declare that the kingdom of God is here. Christ Jesus and our God, they will confirm the kingdom's arrival and presence and operation by healing even in this night in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible teaches that they were healed, everyone. The Lord would also have us to know that not only is he willing to heal all that are sick, it makes no difference what type of sickness or disease a person might have. Sometimes we look at our situations and we say, God can't reach us. Well, somebody needs to know that it makes no difference what type of sickness, what type of disease you have. Jesus Christ could heal a headache just as easy as he could heal stage 4 cancer or leprosy. It makes no difference what type of sickness, what type of disease you have. Remember what the Bible says here about Jesus' ministry. This is Matthew chapter 4, verse 23. The Bible says, "And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom." But then it said that he went about and he was healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. All manner of sickness and all manner of disease. In Matthew 9:35, the Bible says that he preached the gospel of the kingdom and he healed every sickness and every disease among the people. And so somebody needs to know, It makes no difference what type of sickness, what type of disease you have. The power of God is available right here and right now from his heavenly kingdom to heal you. We believe that the Lord is doing a work on somebody now. Even as our faith is being built up, the kingdom of God is coming to somebody right now. Somebody's being healed. Sickness and disease is being driven from somebody's body right now, even as we share this word, because the Lord will prove, authenticate, confirm, verify, and validate that the kingdom of God is here by manifesting the culture, power, and authority of his kingdom, the culture of healing, the culture of deliverance. And so we bless the Lord that Jesus Christ healed every sickness and every disease among the people. Now, not only did Jesus heal every and all manner of sickness and disease, but he also empowered his disciples to do the same thing. And so we praise God that even as Jesus did this, he empowered his disciples, and you and I are now his disciples, for the work of God must continue, my fellow believer. Matthew chapter 10, verse 1, the Bible says, and when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out. And what did he do? He empowered them to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. It makes no difference what type of sickness, what type of disease you have. We bless the Lord that the power of God is here to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Now, because Christ Jesus was manifested to destroy the works of the devil, and through Calvary, he took or carried our infirmities and he bore our sicknesses. Christ Jesus is willing and able to heal anyone of any type of sickness and any type of disease. Now, what about people who are born with certain infirmities? Sometimes we look at people who are born with these infirmities and sicknesses, and we say, surely the Lord can't heal them. Christ Jesus is even able to heal you if you are born with certain ailments, sickness, and disease. The Bible says here in St. John chapter 9, verses 1 to 3, and as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth. In verse 2 of St. John 9, and his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? The Bible says in verse 3, Jesus answered, neither hath this man sinned, nor his parents, but that the works of God should be manifested in him. Then let's take a look at verses 6 and 7 of St. John 9. When he had thus spoken, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay. Then in verse 7, the Bible says, and he said unto him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is by interpretation sent. He went his way, therefore, and washed and came seeing. It made no difference that this man was born blind, my fellow believer. It made no difference. This did not limit Jesus' ability to minister to him. The power of God and his kingdom are able to reach us wherever we are, regardless of the situation that we find ourselves in. Even if we are born with certain sicknesses and disease, the Bible teaches that our God, our Father, our King, and Christ Jesus, they will confirm their kingdom's presence, operation, and arrival here on this earth by healing, even in situations where people were born with sickness and disease. Here is another occasion where somebody who was born with an ailment experienced the benefit of God's kingdom, the benefit of healing. The Bible says in Acts chapter 3, verses 1 to 2, now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. Here it is in verse 2 of Acts 3, and a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Now let's see what happened in verse 6 of Acts 3. Then Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. My fellow believer, it made no difference that this man was born lame. Here it is in verse 7. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. The Bible says in verse 8, and he leaping up stood and walked, and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. This man had never walked before, but Christ Jesus was still able to heal him through his apostles, my fellow believer. Here's Paul and Barnabas down at a place called Lystra. This is Acts chapter 14, verses 8 to 10. Somebody needs to know that God is not limited by your situation. God is not limited by the type of sickness or disease that you might have. God is not limited by the fact that you were born with certain sickness or ailments or irregularities in your body. My fellow believer, it makes no difference. The power of God is here, and the power of God's kingdom can reach you wherever you are. Here again is Paul and Barnabas down in a place called Lystra. This is Acts chapter 14, verses 8 to 10. And there sat a certain man at Lystra, impotent in his feet, being a cripple from his mother's womb, who never had walked. Here it is in verse 9. The same heard Paul speak, who steadfastly beholding him, and perceiving that he had faith to be healed. Look at verse 10 of Acts 14. Said with a loud voice, stand upright on thy feet. And he leaped and he walked, my fellow believer. This man had never walked before. He was impotent in his feet from his mother's womb. But Paul looked at him, told him to stand upright on his feet, and he leaped and he walked. And so he blessed the name of Jesus that the power of God was able to reach him, even though he was impotent in his feet from his mother's womb. But what was the key to this man being able to walk, even though he had never walked before? Well, let's take another look at verse 9 of the same scripture. The Bible says here, the same heard Paul speak, who steadfastly beholding him and perceiving that he had faith to be healed. Again, the same heard Paul speak, who steadfastly beholding him and perceiving that he had faith to be healed. Notice the Bible says that Paul perceived that this man had faith. Why is faith so important in receiving benefits from the kingdom of God? Why is faith so important in receiving benefits from the kingdom of God? Well, here's a word that the Lord spoke to me many years ago. The Lord told me some time ago. He told me that faith is the currency of the kingdom of God. Paul perceived this man's faith. Paul responded to this man's faith. This man's faith was instrumental in him receiving the benefit of healing from God's heavenly kingdom, even though he had never walked before. But somebody needs to know that faith is the currency of the kingdom of God. What are we saying? The way that we use money to make purchases, acquire goods and services, and transact business in the natural realm, we use faith to do the same in the spiritual realm. Even as money is the currency of the natural realm, faith is the currency of the spiritual realm. And so again, the same way that we use money to make purchases, acquire goods and services, and transact business in the natural realm, we use faith to do the same in the spiritual realm. Faith is the currency of the kingdom of God. What did this tell me, my fellow believer? This tells me then that because faith is the currency of the kingdom of God, your true wealth is not limited to or determined by what you have access to in the physical realm, but what you can believe God for. Again, because faith is the currency of the kingdom of God, your true wealth is not limited to or determined by what you have access to in the physical realm, but what you can believe God for. Remember what the Bible says here in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. The Bible says here, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. This speaks to the infinite and unlimited potential of our God and his ability to blow our minds by the things that he wants to do for us. Paul says here in his letter to the Ephesians that our God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. But this scripture does not stop here. Look at what the Bible says, according to the power that worketh in us. This tells me then that God's ability to work for us is determined by the power that works in us. Again, this tells me that God's ability to work for us is determined by the power that works in us. This power is our knowledge, our faith, our walk with God, and our faith-filled confession, my fellow believer. The Bible teaches that God is able, but he's able according to the power that worketh in us. And so the power that works in us determines the extent to which God is able to work for us. Through the medium of faith, we have access to the inexhaustible and immeasurable supply, resources, and potential of the King and the Kingdom of Heaven. Again, through the medium of faith, we have access to the inexhaustible and immeasurable supply, resources, and the potential of the King and Kingdom of Heaven. Faith is what Christ Jesus will respond to as we seek to reach into God's invisible kingdom for our healing and our deliverance. And so we're preparing somebody right now. This is why we're giving you the word of God. This is why we're letting you know that you've been delivered from the power of darkness. You've been translated into the kingdom of God's dear son. You are now in this world, but you're no longer of this world. You're a child of God and you're a citizen of his heavenly kingdom. You have access to rights, privileges, and benefits from God's kingdom right here and right now. And so we're building faith in the minds and the hearts of the people of God. But faith is what Christ Jesus will respond to as we seek to reach into God's invisible kingdom for our healing and our deliverance. Faith gives us the ability to reach into the invisible realm and to extract the things that we need in the visible realm. For the Bible says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Faith, my fellow believer, gives you the ability to tap into resources from God's invisible kingdom. Here's a question that Christ Jesus asked as he taught about the need to be persistent in prayer. Faith is what Jesus Christ will respond to. The Bible says here in Luke chapter 18, verse 8, nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? The Bible is not speaking here about when he comes in the sweet by and by, but he's speaking about when Jesus shows up, when you call him, when he shows up to your situation and your circumstance, my fellow believer. He's coming looking for faith. Faith is what he would respond to. Faith is what Christ Jesus looks for. He's looking for faith. This is what withdraws, or this is what attracts the virtue from God's heavenly kingdom. It is our faith. Here's what Peter said to the council when he was asked by what means he made the man at Gate Beautiful walk, the one who we just saw a little earlier in Acts chapter 3. Here's what Peter said to the council. This is Acts chapter 3, verse 16. Peter told that council, and his name, through faith in his name, hath made this man strong, whom ye see and know. Yea, the faith which is by him hath given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And so this man was made whole by virtue of faith in Jesus' name. Not only the man's faith, but the faith of Peter and John. It was the faith in the name of Jesus that caused this man who had never walked before to jump up and walk and leap and dance and enter into the temple with Peter and John. Faith is what Christ Jesus will be looking for when he comes to your situation. Here's what Jesus told the woman with the issue of blood, whose money could not help her. This is Matthew chapter 9, verse 22. He told her, daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith had made thee whole. And so Jesus told this woman, it was your faith that withdrew the virtue from his body. Remember, the disciples told Jesus that people were thronging him and pressing him. But Jesus asked, who touched me? And so faith gives us the ability to touch Jesus. Faith gives us the ability to withdraw virtue from God's heavenly kingdom. Here's what Jesus said to the two blind men that followed him. Firstly, he asked them in Matthew chapter 9, verse 28, believe ye that I am able to do this? We believe that somebody's faith is being built up right now. They believe that Christ Jesus is able to heal them. He asked them, believe ye that I am able to do this? They said unto him, yea, Lord. Then in verse 29 of Matthew 9, then touched he their eyes, saying, according to your faith be it unto you. When the Son of Man cometh, he's coming looking for faith. Faith is what will attract the virtue of God's heavenly kingdom, my fellow believer. And so we thank God that faith is being built up in somebody's heart, in somebody's mind. Here's what Jesus said to the centurion who petitioned him on behalf of his servant. This is Matthew chapter 8, verse 13. Jesus told that centurion, go thy way, and as thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. Go thy way, and as thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. And so again, it was the faith of this centurion that resulted in the healing and deliverance of his servant. Here's what Christ Jesus said to the Canaanite or Syrophoenician woman. This is Matthew chapter 15, verse 28. When the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith in the earth? And so we thank God that faith is being built up in somebody's heart, in somebody's mind right now. And we praise the name of Jesus that we will combine our faith and make a withdrawal and make a demand on God's heavenly kingdom. Here's what Christ Jesus told this Syrophoenician or Canaanite woman. Jesus told her here in Matthew chapter 15, verse 28. O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. Remember what Jesus said to Martha as he was about to raise Lazarus from the dead. Here it is in St. John chapter 11, verse 40. Jesus told Martha, said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? We believe that somebody's believing tonight, and we will see, we will experience the glory of God. Why? Because we dare to believe. Here's what Jesus said to his disciples who were unable to cast a demon out of a man's son. This is Matthew chapter 17, verse 20. Jesus told his disciples, he said, for verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing and no thing shall be impossible unto you. I believe that some of us have some circumstances in our lives, like sickness and disease. But Christ Jesus lets us know that through our faith, we can speak to these mountains. And he said that nothing shall be impossible unto us. Nothing shall be impossible unto us. Why? Because nothing is impossible unto God. And God is able to work for us according to the power that worketh in us. And so Jesus said that if we have this faith as a grain of mustard seed, we're going to speak to these mountains and nothing shall be impossible unto us. But notice that Jesus said that there's a need for us to speak to our mountains. It's extremely important for us to speak to our mountains. This is important because words activate kingdom function, and words are an expression or indication of what we believe. We speak what we believe, my fellow believer. Again, this is important because words activate kingdom function. If you take a look in your Bible, you see that Jesus Christ always used words to minister to people. Stand upright on your feet. Ears be open. And so he always used words because words activate kingdom function. And words are an expression or an indication of what we believe. We speak what we believe. Here's what Paul says to us through his letter to the Corinthians. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. Paul says, we having the same spirit of faith. We having the same spirit of faith. According as it is written, I believe, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore we speak. And so because we believe, we speak. Why? Because we have that same spirit of faith. Paul said, I believe, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore we speak. And so as an expression of our faith, it is important for us to speak what we believe and to believe what we speak. Here's what King Solomon says to us in Proverbs chapter 18, verses 20 to 21. Solomon says here, a man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips shall he be filled. In verse 21, Solomon said, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. And so we praise the Lord because we were made in the image and likeness of God. And the Bible teaches that God framed his world with his words. And so because we were made in the image and likeness of God, we too are able to frame our world with our words. And so when somebody gives us a negative report, when somebody tells us that we shall die and not live, we shall begin to declare that we shall live and not die. We shall let them know that we are children of God. We are citizens of his heavenly kingdom. And we will walk in divine health. And we will walk in strength. And we will walk in prosperity. And we will walk in joy. And we will walk in peace. And so the Bible teaches that death and life are in the power of the tongue. We have to speak what we believe. And we have to believe what we speak. Because a man's belly shall be satisfied by the fruit of his mouth. And finally, here's what God says to us through the prophet Isaiah. This is Isaiah chapter 57, verses 18 to 19. Isaiah said, I have seen his ways and will heal him. Somebody needs to know that God will heal this night. I have seen his ways and will heal him. I will lead him also and restore comforts unto him and to his mourners. Here is verse 19 of Isaiah 57. Look at what the Lord says to us tonight. I create the fruit of the lips. I create the fruit of the lips. Peace, peace to him that is afar off and to him that is near, saith the Lord, and I will heal him. Notice God is saying to you tonight that he creates the fruit of our lips. And so the thing that we say is what he will create. Our confession is important because our God says that he creates the fruit of our lips. Here's the word that the Lord spoke to me, even as I was in prayer early this morning. Here's this word from the Lord. He said that we are experiencing what we are experiencing in the church today because he is simply confirming the word that we are preaching. Again, we are experiencing what we are experiencing in the church today because he is simply confirming the word that we are preaching. We are primarily preaching and encouraging people to be prepared to die to go to heaven. So people are dying and going to heaven. And so he said, listen to me, man. We are experiencing what we are experiencing in the church today simply because God is confirming the word that we are preaching. We are preaching primarily and encouraging people, be prepared to die to go to heaven. So people are simply dying and going to heaven. He's creating the fruit of our lips, my fellow believer. We are simply experiencing what we are preaching in the church today. But we need to begin to preach the gospel that Jesus Christ preached. Remember Mark's account of Jesus' instruction to his disciples and his response to this message. Firstly, he told them in Mark chapter 16, verse 15, he told them to go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Go ye into all the world and preach what? The gospel to every creature. He told them to preach the gospel. The introduction to Jesus' public ministry confirms what the gospel is that Jesus instructed his disciples to preach. Here again is the scripture that we looked at a little earlier in this lesson. Mark chapter 1, verses 14 to 15. Now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, this is Mark 1 and 15, and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. In addition to this initial declaration, as he began his public ministry, Jesus Christ specifically articulated the gospel that he wanted his disciples to preach. Here again is Matthew chapter 10, verse 7. He said to them, and as ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And so Jesus told these people to go and preach the gospel. The gospel is the gospel of the kingdom. Then look at what happened as they went out and they preached this gospel, the gospel that he told them to preach. Now, as we go back to Mark, the Bible says here in Mark chapter 16, verse 20, and they went forth and preached everywhere. They went preaching the gospel of the kingdom. The Bible says, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. The Bible says that the Lord worked with them and he confirmed the word that they were preaching. The word that they were preaching was that the kingdom of heaven had arrived on the earth. This is the word that he wants to confirm. He wants to manifest the culture of the kingdom. The word that Jesus wants to confirm with signs following is repent, for the kingdom of heaven has arrived on the earth. Our Father and Christ Jesus are committed to demonstrating heaven's power and authority through mighty signs and wonders when we preach the gospel of the kingdom, because they want to confirm that the kingdom of God has arrived on the earth. This was the word that Christ Jesus confirmed with signs following, my fellow believer. They want to create the fruit of our lips. And so when we in the church begin to declare that the kingdom of God is here and that mankind now has access to this kingdom, mankind can now come under God's government and experience the quality of life under God's government and in God's kingdom. Mankind can now experience life and life more abundantly. Mankind can begin to reign in life. Mankind can begin to function as God's kings and as priests. Mankind can begin to function as that chosen generation, that royal priesthood, that holy nation, those peculiar people, my fellow believer. This is what he wants to confirm. He wants to confirm that his kingdom is here. This is the word that he confirmed as his disciples went out and they preached, my fellow believer. Brothers and sisters, as a citizen of the kingdom of heaven and as a child of God, you have a right to divine health. As a citizen of the kingdom of heaven and as a child of God, you have a right to divine health. And so we bless the name of Jesus for this word. We give God thanks, praise, glory, and honor. As a citizen of the kingdom of heaven and a child of God, you need to know that you have a right to divine health. But before we begin to pray, I want to remind you about Jesus' experience with a centurion in Luke chapter 7. Jesus agreed to go to this man's house to heal his servant. But here's what he said to Jesus. This is Luke chapter 7. Verses 6 to 9, the centurion sent this message to Jesus. He said, Lord, trouble not thyself, for I am not worthy that thou shouldest enter under my roof. Lord, trouble not thyself, for I am not worthy that thou shouldest enter under my roof. Here it is in verse 7. Wherefore neither thought I myself worthy to come unto thee, but saying a word, and my servant shall be healed. He said, saying a word, and my servant shall be healed. Why did this man say this? Well, here it is in Luke chapter 7, verse 8. The centurion said, for I also am a man set under authority, having under me soldiers. And I say unto one, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh, and to my servants, do this, and he doeth it. And so this centurion was saying to Christ Jesus, by virtue of the authority that Rome gave me as a centurion, because of this authority that Rome gave me as a centurion, I have power and I have men under me. I am set under authority. And I can say to any soldier under me, go, and he has to go. And I can say to another one, come, and he has to come. And I can say to this other person, do this, and he has to do it. Why? Because of the authority that he had from the kingdom of Rome. Well, my fellow believer, this centurion understood that just as he was empowered by Rome to have dominion and authority over his soldiers, Christ Jesus was empowered by the kingdom of heaven to have dominion and authority over sickness and disease. So this is why he said, you don't have to come to my house just saying a word. The same way that Rome gave me authority to have control over my soldiers, the kingdom of heaven has given you authority to have control over sickness and disease. So all you have to do is say in a word, you don't have to come to my house, and there will be an expectation and there will be healing. So my fellow believer, the Bible says here in Luke chapter 7 verse 9, when Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him and turned him about and said unto the people that followed him, I say unto you, I have not found so great faith. No, not in Israel. And so this man, even though he was not a Jew, even though he was not of the seed of Abraham, he understood kingdom authority. And so somebody needs to know that Christ Jesus does not have to come to your house tonight. We can say in a word, and there will be an expectation that the power of God, the anointing of God, will reach you exactly where you are. We do not have to come to your house, because the power of God is here. Jesus told us that the works that he did shall we do also, and greater works than these shall we do. And so we thank and praise God for this teaching tonight on divine healing, citizens' right, and the manifestation of kingdom culture. And we want to pray for someone tonight. We want to pray. And I want to give you a moment, if you will, to call anybody, to call somebody who has some ailment, some sickness, some disease in their bodies, my fellow believer. I want to give you a moment to call them. Tell them tune in right now to Janine McFaul's Facebook page, because the Lord is about to do a thing. The Lord is about to confirm that his kingdom is here. Somebody's going to be healed. Somebody's going to be delivered right now. Why? Because we are the envoys. We are the ambassadors of Christ. And we have been empowered to speak and to minister the kingdom of God over God's people right here and right now. You know, we invited a few people to attend the Bible study tonight. But we praise God for Miss Kayshell Marshall. She was diagnosed with chondrosarcoma. Chondrosarcoma. That even sound like the devil, my fellow believer. Chondrosarcoma of the pelvis. Miss Kayshell Marshall. We praise the Lord that the name of Jesus is above every name that is named. And the name of Jesus is above the name chondrosarcoma of the pelvis. And so we bless the Lord that Miss Marshall, even now, we believe that the Lord has already started to work on her, because her faith has been built up. She's been strengthened right now. And so we bless the Lord that we will pray for her, because we praise God that we invited her to be here tonight. And we believe that she's here tonight. And so we bless the name of Jesus for her. There shall be a manifestation of kingdom power and authority. We believe that the doctors have said that there's nothing that they can do for her. But we praise the Lord that there's a balm in Gilead. We bless the Lord that there are places where doctors cannot operate, that the King of Heaven can operate on, and he will not leave any scars, my fellow believer. He will operate on Miss Kayshell Marshall this night, and there shall be healing, and there shall be deliverance, and there shall be a testimony, and our faith shall be built up, my fellow believer. And so we bless the Lord. And even as we pray tonight, we also want to remember Bishop Walter Hanschel. We bless the name of Jesus for him. We've been in contact with him. We believe that God will do a work even in his life. And so we bless the Lord. This devil is all about trying to kill, steal, and to destroy with all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. We also want to remember India, which is being ravaged by COVID-19 right now. I have a close bishop friend that I speak to. I spoke to him no longer than today. He calls me his apostle. And so we thank God that through the medium of Facebook, The Bible says that this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness. And so through the medium of Facebook and YouTube, the gospel of the kingdom is going out to India, because this bishop has many churches under him. But he says that his country is being ravaged by this COVID-19 demon. And so we want to pray for that as well. I'm giving somebody some time to reach out to somebody who they know they have some sickness, some disease that the doctors has given up on, my fellow believer. The Lord is about to do a work. Tell them to tune in. Tell them to connect to this Bible study this night and watch God do a work. We believe that God will confirm that his kingdom is here by manifesting the culture, power, and authority of his kingdom. We thank God that somebody's faith has been built up. We thank God that Christ Jesus has already begun to do a work, and he's going to drive the spirit of infirmity from the bodies of God's people. You know, Jesus says a word to us here in Matthew chapter 18, verses 18 to 20. He says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." In verse 19 of Matthew 18, the Bible says, "Again, I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven." Again, Jesus said, "Again, I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven." In verse 20 of Matthew 18, the Bible says, "For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." And so we bless the name of Jesus. We give him thanks and praise, glory and honor for this work that our God is about to do. Let's just bow in a word of prayer as we begin this prayer tonight. Father, we come before in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, we give you thanks, we give you praise, we give you glory and honor, might and dominion and power. Father God, we bless you, Lord God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord God, because we believe that this word has found good ground in the hearts of your people. We believe that somebody's faith is being built up right now. And by virtue, Lord God, of the edification, Lord God, Father God, of your people, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, we've been built up, Father God, on our most holy faith this night, my Father. We are now positioned, Lord God, to reach into your invisible kingdom, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, we thank you, my Father God, because your word declares, my Father God, that through knowledge shall the just be delivered. And so, my Father God, we thank you, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that even now, my Father, you are revealing the mysteries of the kingdom to the people of God. And so, Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, your people now know, Father God, that we are not limited to this world's five loaves and two fishes, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, Father God, we just begin to bless you. We seal this word in the hearts and the minds of the people of God. We thank you, my Father God, that somebody's life is being transformed. And so, Lord God, we begin to bless your holy precious name. Father God, as we begin to pray even now for those who are sick, even now, bless the name of Jesus. And so we bless the name of Jesus. Somebody needs to know that God wants to heal you. God wants to heal you. Everywhere that you hurt, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And so right now, we specifically lift up Miss Keisha Marshall in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We begin to release kingdom power and authority in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right now, we drive that spirit of infirmity from my dear sister's body. We begin to declare, ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, be loosed from this infirmity right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right now, we begin to release kingdom power and authority right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, we thank you, O God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that not only are you healing Sister Marshall's body, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ, but Father God, everyone that is sick even now, Lord God, we lift up, Lord God, Bishop Walter Hanschel, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, our brothers and sisters in India, Lord God, all over the world, Lord God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, Father God, because, O God, in the name of Jesus, notwithstanding the fact, Lord God, that the thief, Lord God, has come to steal and to kill and to destroy, but we thank you, my Father, that Christ Jesus was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. And so, Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we believe that even as Christ Jesus gave his 12 disciples power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases, Father God, we thank you, O God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you've given us the same power and authority, O God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And so, Father God, we thank you, O God. We begin to declare, Lord God, that the kingdom of God is coming to the people of God in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, we begin to thank you, O God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Jesus Christ. That doctor shall be baffled, oh God, by virtue of this operation, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Right now, Father God, we join our faith with the faith of the people of God. You said where two or three are gathered in your name, my Father. Lord God, you promised to be in our midst, and you will hear from heaven, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And so, Father God, we bless your holy precious name, because you blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Lord God, you've raised us up and caused us to sit together in heavenly places. You've given us the keys of the kingdom, oh God. And we know, oh God, that keys are all about access, oh God. And so right now, oh God, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, we begin to wield the keys of faith and the confession, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, we reach into your invisible kingdom, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we begin, oh God, to call forth healing, Father God, and wholeness, Lord God. We declare wholeness, Lord God, from the crown of their heads to the soles of their feet. We declare healing and wholeness, Lord God, from the crown of Sister, Lord God, Keisha Marshall's head to the soles of our feet, my Father. We drive that spirit of infirmity from our body. We, Father God, begin to declare that the kingdom of God has come at her, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. We speak to that pelvis, Lord. We speak to, Lord God, a spine, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. We speak, Lord God, to every muscle in our body, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Everything in our body, my Father, we declare the kingdom of God has come at her, Father God, even now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We call forth your divine order in her body, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we thank you for healing, Lord. We lift up, Lord God, Bishop Walter Hanschel, oh God. We call forth healing and wholeness, my Father, by faith, oh God. Father God, we begin to drive that spirit of infirmity from his body, oh God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you, oh God, that healing is the children's bread, oh God. Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ Jesus said, let the children first be filled. And so, Father God, we thank you that these people are your children, oh God. And Lord God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you, Lord God, because bread, my Father, is symbolic, my Father, of our entitlement, my Father, as your children, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, Father God, we begin to thank you, Lord. Lord God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you're doing a work right now. You're driving sickness and disease, oh God, from the bodies of these people, from the minds of these people, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for a supernatural manifestation of your kingdom, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, we begin to thank you, oh God, for Lord God, Christ Jesus told the Pharisees that the kingdom of God cometh not with observation, neither shall we say, lo here or lo there. For behold, the kingdom of God is among us. The kingdom of God is within us. The kingdom of God is in our midst. And so, my Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for manifesting the kingdom's arrival and presence and operation. Even now, Lord God, we thank you for confirming, oh God, we thank you for proving, authenticate, confirming, validate, and verifying, my Father, that your kingdom is here, oh God, by manifesting the kingdom culture, Father God, of healing and deliverance, oh God. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, because, oh God, we have been delivered from the kingdom of darkness and translated into to the kingdom of your dear son, oh God, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, that there shall be a manifestation of kingdom culture in the lives of your people, oh God, and that devil no longer has authority or jurisdiction over us, because we are no longer citizens of his kingdom. And so, Father God, we begin to thank you, Lord, for healing and deliverance right now, my Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We know, Father God, in the name of Jesus, that you can heal. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that our faith, oh God, Father God, as Lord God, created an expectation, oh God, Father God, that you will do a work, oh God, Father God, even as you, Lord God, Father God, went with your disciples and you confirmed the word with signs following, oh God, we thank you for confirming, oh God, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, this word this night, the word of the kingdom, oh God, in Jesus' name. And so, Father God, we thank you, Lord, for manifesting the culture, power, and authority right here, Father God, and right now, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we bless you, Holy Father, because, Lord God, you came, oh God, that we might have life and that we might have it more abundantly. And so, Lord God, we begin to glorify your name. And thank you, Lord God, that, Lord God, through the cross, Christ Jesus spoiled the principalities and powers, oh God, in the name of Jesus Christ. And so, Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that, Father God, you anointed Jesus of Nazareth, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, with the Holy Ghost and with power. And Jesus Christ went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Jesus went about doing good and healing all that that will press down the devil. And so, Father God, we thank you, oh God, that, Lord God, because you are with us, even as you were with Christ Jesus, we thank you for manifestation, Father God, in the name of Jesus, and healing all, my Father God, this night, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, we stand, my Father, as your diplomats, Lord, as your envoys, Lord God, and your ambassadors, and Father God, we begin to release kingdom power and authority right now, in Jesus' name, hallelujah. God can heal, God is healing right now. We believe God is healing. God is healing right now. He has a miracle for you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, we look at these things, we call them miracles, but they're simply confirmation that the kingdom of God is here. And so as we preach this gospel of the kingdom, he will confirm that his kingdom is here. And so, Father God, we thank you, my Father God, in the name of Jesus. Every spirit of infirmity is driven from the bodies of the people. We take authority over every spirit of infirmity, every sickness, every disease, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We bind every demonic spirit in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. For not only has Jesus given us power and authority to cure diseases, but he gave us power and authority over all devils. Father God, we thank you that Christ Jesus told her. He said, behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and the power over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt us. And so, Father God, we begin to thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Father God, because, Lord God, you, Father God, have translated us into your kingdom. We bless you, Lord, and we call it done, Father God, this night, Lord God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, Father God, we thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that indeed, Lord God, there's healing. Your brokenness is being healed right now. Your brokenness is being healed in God's presence. Your brokenness is being healed right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And so, Father God, we just begin to give you thanks right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, for we are fully persuaded, oh God, Father God, that you're working, Father God, in somebody's life right now. We thank you, Lord God, the divine order is coming to somebody's body right now, somebody's mind, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father God, you're confirming the presence and operation of your kingdom, oh God, in Jesus' name. And so, Father God, we thank you, Lord, that every brokenness, every disorder, my Father, is being removed, Lord God, from the bodies of the people of God even now, my Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, we give you thanks. We give you praise. Your brokenness be healed. Your brokenness be healed right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We declare, oh God, by faith, that there shall be a manifestation of kingdom, Father God, presence and power. Your brokenness is healed right now, my fellow believer. And because your brokenness is healed, we want to begin to confess. We want to confess that we are healed. I want somebody to join in with me right now. Sister Keisha Marshall, I want you to join in with me, and I want you to begin to sing this song. I'm healed by the power of his word. I am healed by the power of his word. Remember, we saw that life and death are in the power of our tongues. And so we begin to testify right now. We begin to confess right now. I'm healed by the power of his word. I wish somebody would join me with this in this song right now tonight in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm healed. I'm healed by the power of his word. I'm healed by the power of his word. I'm healed by the power of his word. We thank God. We thank God. Speak to your situation. We thank you, Lord God. Father God, we thank you. Thank you, Lord God. Father God, we're healed, my Father. We're healed by the power of your word. We're going to speak to somebody tonight. We say, be healed. Be healed by the power of his word. Be healed by the power of his word. Be healed by the power of his word. Be healed. Be healed. Be healed. by the power of his word. No more. Blessed be the holy name of Jesus. Somebody begin to praise God right now. Thank God for the work that he has done. We thank God in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we give you thanks. We give you praise, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Because we believe, oh God, that you are the Lord our God and you change not. As you were, you are, and ever shall be. We still believe that you're able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. And so, Father God, we praise you, my Father. We worship you, Lord God. We give you glory and honor, my Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we begin to bless you, my Father God, even now, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for healing even now, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We just bless you and praise you for this wonderful night, Lord God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We want you alone to be glorified. And so, saints of God, somebody needs to know that there's power in the name of Jesus. You need to know that you are no longer a citizen of the kingdom of darkness. You are now a citizen of God's heavenly kingdom. And by virtue of your citizenship, you have access to certain rights, privileges, and benefits. And indeed, as we've shown you from the word of God this night, one of the major rights, privileges, and benefits that you have is the right to divine health as a child of God and a citizen of God's heavenly kingdom. And so we praise God for each and every one of you. And we want you to be encouraged this night in the name of Jesus Christ. And we want to hear from you. We want to hear from you as you go back to your doctors and your doctors be baffled to see that there's been healing in your body and you are no longer the same. God bless you this wonderful night. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen and amen. Praise God.
You've been listening to a message by Pastor Ezeal McFaul, Kingdom citizen and ambassador of Christ. We trust that this message has been a blessing to you and that in some small way it has helped you to become more knowledgeable about God's kingdom and his righteousness. It is our prayer that God grants you a heart that hungers and thirsts after his kingdom and his righteousness so that you will be filled or supplied and begin to experience the abundant life that Christ Jesus came to make available to his children. If you desire further information about our ministry or access to additional resources, please feel free to contact Pastor McFaul at 242-427-5512 or internationally at 954-284-7909. Dare to take God at his word. Seek his kingdom and his righteousness. Be delivered from the spirit of religion and begin to live life on another level. God bless you is our prayer. There is a king
in you. Let the kings worship him today.